Namaste, everyone. So on behalf of everyone here at Indic Academy, welcome and good evening. Good evening to some of you. To some of you, it's a very early good morning in Bharat. My name is Archana Sunil and your moderator for today's Dose of Enlightenment. First, a very happy 74th Swatantrata Divas to all Bharatiyas. And what a perfect occasion to discuss free will versus destiny in Sanatana Dharma. Sanatana Dharma, also known as Hinduism, as we know, allows for free exchange of ideas. And as with everything else, we've heard that Hinduism is fatalistic, and we've also heard that Hinduism is all about free will. Is it really a clear case of black and white, or is it gray depending on variables? Is it limited in freedom? So to dive into these questions, we have today two panelists who bring two different perspectives, two very practical perspectives, a management professional and an astrologer. So we have Ami Ganatra, who is an engineer and alumni of IIM Ahmedabad. She has over 14 years of experience working across four continents with employers such as Bain & Company. And Ami is an ardent yoga practitioner, a certified yoga instructor, and a student of Sanskrit and Indic wisdom. In her free time, she loves exploring people, places, and cultures. She blogs her travelogues and musings at dharmorakshitarakshitarakshitaha.wordpress.com. Welcome, Amiji.
Namaste. Thank you, Archana. Very, very happy to be here, and a very happy Independence Day to all my fellow Indians and American friends out there.
Super. And then we have Ashwini Sahastrabuddhe, who is a merit-ranking chartered accountant and a CPA. Ashwini ji has been a finance professional for over 25 years and is a recipient of several awards in the corporate financial industry. She has spent over a decade as an astrologer and a tarot consultant, helping individuals recognize their strengths, blind spots, and karmic balances via empirical astrology. Welcome, Ashwini ji.
Namaste, Archana ji. Namaste to all Bharatiyas, and a very happy Independence Day to all. Thank you.
Yes. Super. Now, Ashwini ji, before we dive in, I have to tell you this. I've had at least a handful of people ask me, what is empirical astrology? So is that a whole different science? Can you tell us real quickly what you mean by empirical astrology?
Sure. See, empirical means what can be observed, seen, noted, measured, you know. So for thousands of years, our sages used to note down the effects of stars and planets in the lives of people. And that's how emerged the Hora Shastra, or the predictive astrology, or the Phala Jyotish. And they say Parashar, Hora Shastra is the oldest, and Parashar was at the time of Mahabharata. So probably 7,500 years old. And empirical basically means I have clients with me for over 10 years now. So when I note down what are the possibilities in their lives, I also note down why I'm saying so. And then I can track it, you know, what actually happened versus what I had predicted. That's why I call it empirical.
I see. So it's measurable is what you're saying.
It's measurable. It's trackable.
So we can track it. Okay. Got it. Okay. So with that, should we just jump into the questions we have so far?
Yes.
Okay. Super. All right. So here's the first question. If present is the outcome of our past actions or inactions, mm-hmm. which we call karma, mm-hmm. right? And if present actions and inactions also determine our future, mm-hmm. does our past have an influence on the choices we make in the present? And in what way? Amiji, you want to go first?
Sure. Let me talk about it from a very system perspective. Yeah, how do we think? There's a saying, we say a burnt child dreads fire. The first experience of the child has been with the fire, that memory has stayed in his mind. And next time he sees the fire, he is going to, depending on his past memory, decide whether he wants to go near the fire or go away from it. Right? That's one example. Second, human beings is one thing. See how intelligent systems work. Google, first time you search something, it's fine. It will show you whatever is answered. Next time, it knows what you clicked. And it will throw up things depending on what you had seen before. And what do we call this? We call it intelligent systems. So in any self-sustaining intelligent system, you will have an aspect of memory where the past will leave impressions, and depending on those impressions, you will make choices of the future.
Oh, I see.
Now there is a catch here. There are multiple impressions that get made over time, right? So for a future choice, how do you decide and which impression do you pick? That becomes a question. I'll take a very simple example. There's a cigarette. Somebody tried a cigarette, they got a lot of pleasure out of it. That's one memory impression. But there has been a bombardment that, oh, cigarette is not good for you. You have seen others suffer, right? Mm-hmm. Now, the second time the cigarette comes in front of me, I have both those memories in my mind. Which one do I allow to decide my action? Is it the pleasure factor or the knowledge that it's not good for me? So that determines my present action coming from the past. That's how I would put it.
So you're saying there's some residual memory that influences the choice we make in the present.
Absolutely. Actually, it plays a major role unless and until a person is so aware that we can leave behind the past and completely look at things from what they are, which usually doesn't happen. Most of us would depend on what we know, right? Not just intuition.
So there is some prior knowledge happening. Got it. Ashwini ji, what do you have?
Yeah, excellent. I mean, I'll take this forward, you know. So Yog Vasishtha is a document which documents Vasishtha's teachings to Ram to elevate him in his spiritual journey. And he quotes, you know, the fruition of self-effort by which we experience the good and evil of our past action is called daivam or fate. He goes further to explain that the self-effort, you know, we are talking of free will here. The self-effort can be categorized into two categories. One is all the past births and one of the current life. Both counter-interact with each other. Whichever is more powerful triumphs. So he very clearly kind of distinguishes. And Sanatan Dharma, we believe in reincarnation. We believe in the cycle of birth and death. And the karma cycle, you know, how does karma get created? So there are three fundamentals, according to me, of Hindu Sanatan Dharma, which is achar sahishnuta, which is endurance in conduct, vichara swatantra, free will, freedom of choice, freedom of thought, and niti dharma drudata, which is conviction in the niti dharma, conviction in the righteousness. And that's how karma gets created, you know. And when I, as an astrologer, when I start to analyze any horoscope, the first thing I do is to calibrate the personality of the client. So his possible strengths, weaknesses, likes, dislikes, capabilities, potentialities, etc. What kind of choices he's likely to make because of his inherent, you know, personality that he's got from the previous life. I call this the karma balance sheets. I'm also in finance, so I'm kind of karma balance sheet. So right. Typically, balance sheet will have equity and assets, you know. So I say the equity is what we, our purva sanchit, you know, what we have got from our past lives, from our past births. The asset is us, you know, the body, the mind, intellect, the emotions, the convictions. So that's what we come with. That's our opening balance, you know. This life that we are leading with all our, you know, responsibilities, duties, passions, creates karma. And that I map it to the profit and loss account. So at the end of this life of ours, suppose the balance is good karma, it's a profit. It will get added to the equity. If it's a loss, it gets reduced from the equity and the balance gets carried forward. So the cycle of life and death continues. So janmata nishchaya mrityu marata nishchaya janmaya. So, you know, it keeps on continuing. That's what I think.
Wow, that's interesting. Okay. Very good analogy. Thank you so much. That's super. Excellent. If we look into itihasa, right? I'm looking for an example. Maybe one of you can pick Ramayana and the other can pick Mahabharata, where can you give us an example from each of those itihasas where free will was exercised? And what I mean by that is, I want to understand, or we want to understand, how the outcome may have been different if in this particular example that you may have, mm-hmm. if free will had not been exercised. So I'm trying to, so an example of where free will was exercised and what the outcome may have been if it wasn't exercised. Mm-hmm. So perhaps Ashwiniji, you can go first. Maybe you can pick Ramayana, Mahabharata. Do you have some example in mind?
Yeah, I mean, there are plenty, but let's pick the example of Sita.
Okay.
So when Dashrath sentenced Ram for 14 years exile on the insistence of Kaikai, he mm-hmm. gave an option to Sita. He said, you know, you need not drag yourself with me. You can stay in the palace, you know, and do not take any efforts to come with me and lead a life in the forest.
Right.
So Vashishta had plans to make her, crown her as a queen in Ram's absence for 14 years.
However, oh, I didn't know that. Oh.
Yeah. There are some verses, you know, in the Ramayana, and she chose she wanted to follow Swadharma. She chose to be with Ram because she wanted to be with Ram. So though she had an option, though they were all very, you know, okay with her staying back, she chose to go with Ram. And had she not, we wouldn't be talking Ramayana.
That's right. So had she not, then
Ravan wouldn't have thought of taking her.
That's right. Yeah. Amiji, what about you? Do you have an example, say, from the Mahabharata?
Yeah, I'll take a Mahabharata example.
So
let's take two people in Mahabharata, Vidur and Bhishma. Now, when, let's take only one incident of that, which was when Draupadi was humiliated by the Kauravas, right? Both of them were sort of employees of the Hastinapur Empire. One chose to oppose whatever was going on, not bothering about what would happen to him, right? He said, I don't think this is right. So Vidur said, I don't think whatever is going on is right and this should not happen. And he used his free will eventually and said, I will not even fight the war. What did Bhishma do? Bhishma also had that choice. But he chose to tie himself up in the pratigya that he had taken, the oath he had taken. So while he had the free will to say, fine, oath is good enough, I can still exercise my free will and do what is right, he chose to stick with his oath. Now, had he not chosen to stick with his oath, Mahabharata wouldn't have happened because he was a key person. He and Karna were two people based because of whom Duryodhan was so sure that he can fight the war. So had Bhishma said that I'm not going to fight the war, Mahabharata wouldn't have happened. Now,
right. And
Amiji, had Bhishma not taken the oath also, Mahabharata wouldn't have happened.
Agree. That is also a very good point. The characters, both in Mahabharata and Ramayana, are using their free will, depending on how they choose to see and define themselves. And that's the more important point. The free will we have, but we constrain ourselves based on our own definitions of ourselves, more often than not.
Got it. And in all of those cases, you're saying, both of you seem to agree that some residual memory from previous karmas have play a role in whatever decisions they make or choices they make. They may have made.
As we said, the fundamentals are achar, vichar, and niti. Each one of them kind of based their actions on these three. What their convictions are and the freedom of thought. So everything was based on that, and everything normally is based on this.
Got it. Okay. Now, I'm a new student of the Bhagavad Gita, and from what I've understood, and correct me if I'm wrong, Sri Krishna tells Arjuna, and indirectly is telling us, that karma phalam is not in our control. Mm-hmm. Only the karma per se is something we have any say in. And we're told that we dedicate our karma to the Almighty and then accept all the karma phalam, which is not in our control, as prasadam. So I'm sure we've all said this to our kids, right? Work hard and the results will show, correct? But many times we've also seen that the results are not proportionate to the hard work. So why then do we tell our kids, work hard, the results will show when we know that the karma phalam is not in our control. So how would you actually explain? Because I have my kids ask me that question, and I'm glad I have you guys here to help me explain that. So maybe Amiji first.
Okay. Let me take a little bit of time to address this question, because this is very interesting and very relevant as well, right?
Yes.
Let me start with an example. You know, we have lots of youngsters here. Everybody's heard of Steve Jobs, Apple.
Okay. Right.
So Steve Jobs had a difficult childhood, whatever. He got out of it. He founded Apple. When Apple was doing well, this man who founded Apple was sacked from Apple. He was thrown out. Just imagine, the founder of the company is thrown out. It's a huge setback, right? You have not got the phala of your karma. That's what one can say at that point. Ideally, people should have like done puja of him for founding that. But he was sacked. What did he do? He said, fine, whatever. He went out and he found another equally good company, Pixar, for animations. Eventually, Apple took him back. Okay, that's one example. Second, Jack Ma, Alibaba. Everybody knows Alibaba and Jack Ma. 10 times he wrote to Harvard and was rejected. 10 times. Eventually, he did not get through Harvard. Now he goes to Harvard to give talks. But he did not get through Harvard. He was rejected from 30 companies when he applied for a job. 30 companies. Even KFC rejected him. Yeah? Because all that happened, he founded his own company. Many other things that led to founding of internet-related Alibaba and stuff. And look at him now. Okay?
Right.
So, question one. What is guaranteed success? Only what we want, or something more than that? Or something less than that? Yeah? So, what is the time frame of success? And what is the definition of success? Question one. Second, when Krishna says, karma phala is not in your control, why is he saying that? Of course, this comes from the verse karmanmeva adhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana.
Correct.
In the 18th chapter, Krishna actually explains that why is he saying what he's saying. It is not random. Krishna doesn't say anything random. It's very logical. He says, to do any activity, to get a result, there are 5 factors. Panchayatani Mahabahu, 18, 13. Chapter 18, Shloka 13. 5 factors. Which are these 5 factors? One is Adhishthan, Karta, Karan, Prithak Vidha Cheshta, and Pancham is Daivam. The destiny part is there. It's the 5th one. But there are 4 other factors. Which are these? Adhishthan. Now, Adhishthan can be considered as the environment. Say if you're doing a lab experiment. Yeah. So the lab, environment in the lab, having all that, that is the Adhishthan, the substratum on which you base an activity. Then you have the Karta. Who is doing it? Is he a qualified scientist or any other person is doing it? Then does he have the right apparatus? Karna, Karana. Yeah, the right chemicals, right apparatus to do that experiment. And then 4, does he know the right procedure to do that experiment? Right? The Prithak Vidha Cheshta, the different activities that he's doing. Then 5th is the Daivam. Daivam, which is destiny. Now you see, today also in project management, we have, whenever we make a project plan, there is always either a contingency plan or a risk factor. Right? That risk factor is what is actually Daivam. But Daivam is not in our control. The other 4 are. Right? So unless and until those 4 are properly done, how will we know whether the Daivam is going to support us or not? Only when we do an activity can we expect a result out of it where Daivam might have a role to play. Without doing, nothing will happen. If Jack Ma had not done and given up at that point, that forget it, I'm not getting a job, let me run away, like Arjun was trying to run away, right? Then the Daivam wouldn't have played a part at all. So to trigger destiny also, you need to work. Right? Now, 3rd part. Why is Krishna saying take it as a prasad? Yeah? Because lot of times, what stops people from doing what they're doing is the fear of failure.
True.
Right? That is what stops people. Now, he's telling Arjun that you don't worry about... Okay, Arjun is more worried about losing his people. His grandfather and all of that. He's saying, don't worry about that. You do what you must do. You know, it's like there's a small child. When kids are small, you put them on a tree and ask them to jump. They jump. They're not fear. They don't care, right? Why?
Right.
Because somewhere they feel that my mother or my father will hold me. They've asked me to jump. They will hold me. It's their concern. And I jump. I take that risk. As we grow, we start taking all that only in our hands. Right? And that is why we are more scared of losing, fear of losing out, fear of losing. And that is why he's saying, don't fear, don't worry. Because you don't know what is going to happen. The beauty is in the process. The beauty is in doing what you do. You can do what you do to the best of your abilities. And let things follow. Don't constrain yourself in your definition of success, because you don't know how much more is out there for you. So that's what I want to say.
So you don't know what you don't know.
You don't know what you don't know.
Exactly. Okay. Ashniji?
Yeah. In the Gita, Krishna talks of three gunas, sattva, raja and tama. So mm-hmm. He says, person with sattvic gun will voluntarily give up the fruits. He is not attached to the fruits or the outcome of his effort. A person with the rajasic gun will do the effort, want the fruits. And a tamasic person is lazy, basically may not want to do anything. And he encourages each one of us to increase the sattvikta in us.
Right.
Three underlying, you know, the three takeaways for me from three teachings, the main key teachings are nishkama karma yoga, anasakta karma yoga. So do your karmas, do what is right thing to do your swadharma without being attached to the outcome. Second is equanimity, practice equanimity, samabuddhi, sukha dukhe samekritva labha labha jaya jayu. So be the same, whether it is defeat, whether it is victory, whether it is gain, whether it is a loss. And the third thing he says, be a sthita pradna. So withdraw all your desires, just like a turtle who withdraws all his body parts under his shell. A person learn to withdraw his desires. So these are the three takeaways, you know, from Bhagavad Gita. And once a person starts practicing that, possibly, you know, it's easier to deal with. So it's not actually right to say that possibly our interpretation that efforts are not in, the results are not matching the efforts. So we may be not right in actually matching them. We may have a very short-term view, you know, it's 1 year, last 10 years or 20 years, lifetimes, you know, where possibly we'll get there where we have to be. What is important is adhishtan. What Amiji said, adhishtan, having a dream, having a vision and pursuing it passionately is extremely important. And Krishna also says that I'm going to be with you throughout the journey, either as a upadrishta, anumanta, bharata, bhokta or a maheshwar. If you just sit here doing nothing, he is going to be an observer, upadrishta. If you start making an attempt to do something, he is going to be Anumanta. He is going to nod his head. Yes, go ahead. If we start really pursuing our dreams, working hard, doing our responsibilities, etc., he is going to be a Bhakta. He is going to be protector in our journey. And once we start enjoying the fruits of our efforts, he's going to be the Bhokta. He'll also enjoy it with us. But ultimately, he wants us to reach the Sattvikta where we give up the fruits. That is the time he'll become Maheshwar with us. That is, we will become one with us or he will become one with us. So that's what he, throughout Bhagavad Gita, if you see, he says, Arjun, get up, yuddha kar. Arjun, get up, fight the war. Arjun, that's the right thing. That is your swadharma. You will win. He says that in one of the chapters also, you will win, but go and fight. Remove the moha, you know, remove that attachment. Also, coming back to astrology, when I analyze, there are certain charts which I get, which actually I can see that this person is going to get things late, like, you know, career, relationship, marriage. It's going to be a little late in his or her life, or it's going to be a little less. But that's what he's. But nobody's told anyone to, you know, kind of stop trying. So in that sense, as Amiji rightly said, also, the five things that she said, you know, like adhishtanam, karta, karanam, prithakvicham, and daivam. I can tell you one small story on the daivi part. You know, I feel that daivam is also based on your karmas of the past. Daivi shakti also doesn't help, doesn't happen just like that. There's a small story, you know, Acharya Vinoba Bhave. So he was sitting near a mud poodle and he saw a small worm trying to come out of that poodle. So he tried once, fell down, second time, three times, 10 times. So Vinoba ji, he put a small straw in the poodle. He put a stick, and with the help of the stick, the worm came out. Now, mm-hmm. had the worm not been trying, Vinoba wouldn't have noticed. So just because the worm was trying, all kinds of efforts he was trying to put, Vinoba saw it and put the straw. So for the worm, that daivi help was, daivam was Vinoba. But mm-hmm. in trying, he would have been sitting there and Vinoba would have been sitting here in the poodle.
That's true. So it's so you're both agreeing then that what may be karma phalam in my mind may not be what is the ultimate karma phalam, and therefore the effort needs to continue.
Yeah, I mean, let's talk of even only this current lifetime. You know, like every company has a corporate vision. They have a vision statement. They break it into a strategic business plan, a 10-year plan, a 5-year plan. They break it into an annual budget. This budget is monitored every month. You know, where are we versus where we want to be? Course corrections. Mm. What we need to also do in our current life. And we want to get there.
And I will just add to what Archana ji, you asked, right? Karma phalam may not be what we think it to be. I think karma phalam is one aspect. The thing is, the journey of doing the karya itself is a phalam in itself, right? Because think of it, like, you are, every time we do any work, we are getting enriched. We are getting Correct. That experience. So that learning itself is a phalam of what we are doing too, right? We don't tend to
that's very true.
Look at it that way.
And yeah, that's very yoga, in Yoga Vasishtha, Vasishtha calls Daivam as fictitious. He calls fate as fictitious. He's quoted whatever we call fate is fictitious. So it's a lot to do with your own,
Vasanas. Got it. And moving on to the next question. Women exercising free will. We discussed Sitama. Do you guys have other examples from Itihasa where women have exercised free will? Other than Sita, we already talked about Sita. Amiji?
Okay. So actually, women have exercised free will throughout, right? Ramayana, not just Sita. Kaikai also exercised her free will. Yes. Shurpanakha also exercised her free will when she went and complained to
Ravana.
But I will. I want to talk about another beautiful story of Mahabharata, like Shakuntala. Yeah. So Shakuntala and Dushyant. Shakuntala was, they say, a daughter of Vishwamitra and Menaka. But that apart, she grew up in the hermitage of Rishi Kandva. Now, when she was young, she was very pretty. The king of Hastinapur that time, Dushyant, he came to the forest. Yeah. He came to the forest. They saw each other. They fell in love. Now, at that point, Rishi Kandva was away. We talk about that the Indians only arrange marriage. That's what we say, right? But that's not so true. We are talking about like centuries centuries ago. They fell in love and they got married. Married in the sense they consummated the marriage because it is called Gandharva Vibha. And both of them felt very strongly about it. Okay. So because Dushyant had stayed there for some time and then he went away. Dushyant was like, I will send somebody to get you to my palace. Now he goes away and in the meanwhile, Shakuntala becomes pregnant. So it was her own choice. Yeah, she was not duped into this. It was her choice to get married to Dushyant. Then the baby came, but Dushyant, no sign of Dushyant at all. So when the baby, who is Bharat, from whom Mahabharat comes, Bharat, when he was, I think, 11 or 12 years old, Shakuntala, Rishi Kandva, they went to Dushyant. He didn't come, but they decided to go themselves, right? Shakuntala didn't like sit in her ashram and cry all day. She went and she said that, you know what, you've forgotten me, but I'm your wife. And this is your son. Now, Dushyant initially refuses to even acknowledge them or even, identify them. Doesn't remember them. Kalidas has a version where Shakuntala is shown very, pitiable woman. But in the Mahabharat version of the story, she is one strong woman. She actually fights. I mean, not in a bad way, but she tells Dushyant that you don't have the right to speak to a woman like that, especially the one who's your wife. And you will have to accept your son. And it's a huge dialogue that goes on between them in the full assembly. Eventually, they say that, the Daivat happened. Somebody from the top said that, yeah, you know, she's right, and they get the ring back, all of that. But the thing is, Shakuntala took the initiative to do what she must do. She was not sitting and crying in the hermitage because Dushyant didn't come back. She did not just turn around and come back because Dushyant refused to accept her, right?
Got it.
So that is clearly free will, because of which Mahabharat happened. No Bharat, no Mahabharat. So
that's right. Very true. That is true. Shriji, you have another example, or are you good with Sita?
See, no, actually there are many, you know, there isn't
that. That is true.
You have Savitribai Phule, you have Anandi Gopal Joshi, the first woman practitioner, medical practitioner. Savitribai Phule was the first woman, you know, she, the lady who built the first woman's school for girls, you know, at that
point. Right.
There are many such examples, but let me talk of Ahalya, you know, in the Ramayana times. So Ahalya was the devoted wife of sage Gautam.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is an example of a bad free will and a good free will. So free will can be exercised in a righteous manner and a non-righteous manner also. She's done both.
Sure.
So she kind of got tempted to go with Indra one day, and she did that. So she exercised her free will, went with Indra, and realized a mistake. Of course, Sage Gautam denounced her. I mean, kind of, he said, do deep sadhana, do deep penance. She realized her mistake, and she did a great deep sadhana and penance. And not only one Sage Gautam back, but also exalted her to the status of Pativratas. You know, we have those five
Pativratas. Right.
Draupadi, Tara, Mandodari, Sita, Tatha. So she, you know, exalted to that. And another example I want to give is Jizabai, Shivaji Raje's mother. Now, Shivaji Raje's father was a Sardar at the Nizams and then Adil Shah also. And so they had a princely life, and Jizabai could have continued to, you know, live a nice royal life with him. But she couldn't bear the Mughal invasion. She just couldn't bear to see the Maharashtra and the entire country getting devastated because of Mughal invasion. So she planted the seeds of Hindavi Swaraj in her son's mind, you know, in her son's heart, that is Shivaji's heart. And not only did she do that, she also made sure that he got trained accordingly by, you know, say Dadoji Kondev or his other masters or colleagues or whoever. So I'm deeply inspired by Jizabai, actually. Making Shivaji.
Yes, you are right. It's innumerable, the examples of women exercising free will. That's very true. Yeah. Now, I know there are lots of scriptures that address this topic of free will, right? Do you each have, say, an example of a verse that's inspired you? Perhaps you could share that verse with us and what it means.
Sure.
Ashniji?
Okay, you want me to go?
Yeah.
So, okay.
Or maybe you should take a breath. Maybe Amiji, go.
No, I can go ahead.
Okay.
No, see, after reciting the entire Bhagavad Gita, so Krishna talks of Dhyana Yoga, Sankhya Yoga, Karma Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, and all the yogas. Finally, at the end of the chapter, end of the 18th chapter, he says, Itita Jnanam Akhyatam Guhyat Guhyataram Maya. Itita Jnanam Akhyatam Guhyat Guhyataram Maya. So, hey Arjuna, I have given you a very complex knowledge. I have, this is not easily available to everybody. Then he says, Vimrushaita Dasheshena Yathechasi Tathakuru. Vimrushaita Dasheshena Yathechasi Tathakuru, which means now you understand what I have told you. You try to think about it and then do what you think is right. So ultimately he says, exercise your free will and do what you think is right. At the end of all, entire Bhagavad Gita, the last thing he tells Arjuna, exercise your free will based on what you think is right. And what more powerful than that can be, you know?
Right, very true. Super.
Also, this bootstrapping, we heard corporations bootstrapping. You try to get yourself out of a particular situation.
Mm-hmm.
We have a beautiful shlok in Bhagavad Gita. Uddharet atman atmanam natmanam avasadayet. Atmaiva atmano bandur, atmaiva ripuratmana. So the atma is, use the divine strength of your atma to uplift yourself. Atma can be your best friend and atma can be your worst enemy. So it's we who can help us, you know, like that.
Got it. Amiji?
Yeah. I love that shloka, Yathaichasi Tathakuru. And throughout, right, Krishna says you have to fight your own battle. I can only be a sarathi. I will not fight for you. You have to fight for yourself. I think that's the beautiful shloka, Ashwini. I want to take a shloka from Brihadaranyak Upanishad. It doesn't directly talk of free will, but it represents generally what the Sanatani philosophy talks about free will, yeah, or the desire to do work. So it says, kamamai evam eva ayam purushah yatha kamo bhavati tat kratur bhavati yat kratur bhavati tat karma kurute yat karma kurute tat abhi sampadyate. It says purush, either you can think of it as man or it's the atma, what Ashwini ji said, utharet atma, yeah? So it says what our atma or our self, what we are, it's driven by our desires. The desires that we have, according to that will be our resolve. Whatever will be our resolve, we will act according to that. That is the motivating factor, right? We need to be driven by something to act.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. So that will be our motivating factor. So karma kurute. And whatever you do, that so accordingly you will achieve. Abhi sampadyate. Accordingly you will reach your goal or accordingly you will achieve depending on what you have done. So this comes in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. Yeah. So even much before Gita, the philosophy has been exactly that. That there is an act, there is an aspect of Daiva, which actually, as Ashwini ji said, right, is also based on your past karmas. So it is not right. That it is out of nowhere, that somebody sitting out there is deciding and giving you that. It is also based on your past karmas. You, and even now, what you become is based on what you do. So we can never forget. Yad bhavam tad bhavati. That is another thing which is there. And I want to say one, I want to bring this very beautiful Subhashita because I think it's very relevant here. It says, yatha ekena chakrena na rathasya gatir bhavati. With one wheel, the ratha, the chariot cannot run, right? You need two wheels for a chariot. Evam purushakarena vina daivam na siddhyati. That unless and until a man makes effort, daivam by itself cannot do anything.
Ah,
you have to use your effort to trigger your daivam also.
Got it. I had once, I can't remember which, I read somewhere once that it, in the analogy of driving, there's a nail in the wall and how much effort you need to put to pull the nail out depends on how deep the nail is inside the wall. And we don't know how deep it is. Our job is to just keep putting the effort to pull it out. So that makes sense, yeah. Mm. Now, so this is all with Sanatana Dharma and our philosophy. You know, in general, like if you take the major religions of the world, right? I think it's fair to categorize them broadly as, you know, Abrahamic religions and the Dharmic religions, right? Jainism, Buddhism, Hinduism. So do you, in based on your readings and learnings, do you see any, how do the Abrahamic religions handle free will, destiny, compared to the Dharmic religions? Amiji?
Wherever there is a concept of punishment and reward, it assumes an amount of free will on its own, right? Because you cannot be punished for what you have not done. So this is true for everything. You will be punished only if you can have the agency of what you do. The difference is in the degree of free will and the who is allowed the free will, yeah? So if you see in Sanatana Dharma, it is not as if you worship Krishna, you have free will. If you worship Shiva, you don't have free will. It's not like that. Mm-hmm. Even in Gita, Krishna says, yam, 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 yam. Whoever, whatever way wants to worship anybody, if they do it well, they will get what they want. Okay? It doesn't matter that you, it's not as if you have to worship any one person. Now, what happens in Abrahamic religion is that the concept of us versus them is much stronger, as I understand. And, you know, based on my understanding of things. There are people, if you believe, say, in Christianity for the Ten Commandments, then you will be liberated. You will be salvaged, right? If you don't believe, then you are already doomed forever. Similarly, we have the concept of kafir and non-kafir. So if you do not believe in the book, you are doomed forever. So already that free will is gone because of just your not believing in something. Right? So the free will, even the punishment and reward, is only based on people who are within that framework of the believers.
Got it.
Not for anybody else.
So the definition itself varies. The definition
exactly.
itself. Okay,
yeah.
Got it.
That's one big difference. I think the other is also the degree of free will, right? Like as Ashwini ji said, yatha ichchasi tatha kuru. You do what you want and accordingly will be your result. In Abraham, wherever there are religions of the book, it becomes more like do what is in the book. Now, whether it's correct, not correct, morally right, not morally right, all that is not your concern at all. As long as you do what is in the book, you can get heaven or not get heaven. Now, I'm putting it very simplistically. Yeah, I'm sure
correct.
There will be more nuances to it around
correct.
That. But broadly, from an external perspective of Abrahamic religions, this is how it looks to me. It's
God.
Easier to follow because I don't have to think too much about what is good or not good. Right? I do what is told to me. It's much easier. For us, it's a lot more mental activity to figure out, and we are always in this ethical dilemma. Which
and like you said, even with free will, there is the right way to use free will and the not right way to use free will. Right. Ashwini ji?
Yeah, I mean, I completely agree. Monotheist religions, as we call them, the Abrahamic
correct.
Religions. And
yeah.
Bruce Campbell defines them very nicely, you know. He says Judaism is the God's chosen race. They call themselves the God chosen. Islam is, of course, the religion of the book, the Holy Quran. I've read Quran, by the way, almost 80%, but yeah, some other time. And Christianity is salvation through community, that is follow Jesus. So that's what they are. And it is, yes, it is this way or the highway. So in that sense, they really strangulate free will vis-a-vis Sanatan Dharma. Yes, there are within Sanatan Dharma, we have Jainism, Buddhism, Sikhism, which are offshoots of our dharma. In some way, they are a little restrictive, but our dharma is actually complete free will and karma yoga. I mean, it's a, you want to do saguna bhakti, you want to do nirguna bhakti, duality, non-duality, dvaita, advaita. I mean, dvaita is, this is God and this is me. Advaita is, this is the ocean, I'm a drop in it. So me, there's not much difference between me and God. You choose any god, as Amiji said, you know, you can worship Krishna, Lakshmi. You need not worship gods. You can worship planets, stars. You can worship Shani Dev. You can worship Surya Dev. You can worship moon, sun,
right.
stars. So there is a huge, huge free will. And basically, Sanatan Dharma, we all believe that we all are on a karmic wheel. So imagine a 100-story building. I'm probably on the first floor. You might be on the fifth floor. Somebody may not have even reached the building. But all of us are on that spiritual journey, and the ultimate aim is moksha, liberation.
Right.
That's right. And there are so many ways to achieve it. There's not just one right way.
Got it. And on the topic of varna, right, which is a much contested topic these days, I often hear that, you know, Hinduism doesn't allow you to choose which varna you're born into. And hence, you cannot have a choice in which direction your life goes because you can't choose which varna you are born into. Are the two even related? And if they are, in what way?
So you want me to take that?
Go ahead.
Yeah, okay. So Hinduism, I don't think binds anybody from to any varna, you know. In fact, Krishna and Bhagavad Gita says that I have created the four varnas based on a guna and karma. So chatur varne maya srishtam guna karma vibhagasha. So based on qualities and deeds, I have created the varnas. In fact, there are qualities prescribed which are a must for each varna. So krushi goraksha vanijam vaishya karma sabhavajam. So to be a vaishya, one needs to be practicing farming, one needs to be taking care of cows, cattle, one needs to be have entrepreneurial skills, you know. Then paricharya
right.
karma, shudra sapi svabhavajam, which means paricharika. Paricharika is a nurse. So anybody who has a quality of dedication, who is trustworthy, who is skilled in the, and who wants to work for the welfare of humanity is a shudra. And Sanatan Dharma doesn't restrict anyone, you know, that you must follow this because you are born. There are so many examples in history like Drona, Valmiki, Vishwamitra, they've changed their varnas. Drona was a Brahmin who became a Kshatriya. Vishwamitra was born a king who became a Rishi. Valmiki was a thief who became a Rishi. Krishna also, right. You know, Krishna has played all the roles. So as a strategist to Pandavas, he was a Brahmin. As a charioteer, Arjuna's charioteer, he was a Vaishya. As a Gopalak, he was a Vaishya. He fought wars as a Kshatriya. And in the Yajna conducted by Yudhishthir, he was doing the dishes of the invitees. So he was a Shudra there. And Archana ji, you, me, Ami ji, we play all different roles, right? Like I'm born in one family, but I'm doing accounting and finance all my life as a professional. I am doing dishes and cooking for the children. I'm doing a Agnihotra in my house every evening. And here we are trying to burst the myths of Sanatana Dharma as intellectual Kshatriyas. So I think there is contradiction. Yes, in the last 200 years, there was a Vikruti, I would say, that came about. You know, the untouchability, etc. But I think that trap us into, or kind of typecast us into, you know, Varnas or casteism or nothing like that. I think we are beyond it already now.
Yes, and there is absolute freedom or free will for mobility between the Varnas. So there's really not that. Amiji, what's your take?
You know, when we say a person is born with varna, so what is varna? Varna is a color. One meaning of varna is color. Color, as Ashwini ji has been talking about prakriti, right? Rajas, tamas, sattva. Every person is born with a set of qualities, right? Not just us, not just in Hinduism, everywhere, right? We come with a DNA. That DNA gives us a predilection, an inclination towards certain things. What we like, what we don't like. We come with those sorts of things ingrained in us. Anybody, not just a Hindu, right? What has happened in Sanatana Dharma is they said that people typically have such and such and such qualities. And these qualities can be mapped to certain professions, which were the key professions of those times. Okay? So that's how it started. Now, if a person is great at business, he was doing business, right? And we say that, you know, sometimes they say ki, are business to inke khoon mein hai. The person has blood in his business, because they have seen it all their lives, and they also do good in it because maybe they have the inherent prakriti to do that. Now varna is those categorizations based on professions and qualities. That's how it was. So now there, if I'm born in a Vaishya family, but if I have intellectual capability, I can be a Brahmin. Later on, what happened is that varna became community specific, that is jati, right? Mm. Now jatis then started having their own professions because knowledge was passed from person to person to person within the family, right? Obviously, they did better at it. Like even now, as we see, doctor's family, more likely the person will become a doctor and even succeed. That's how it was even more at that time. So varna is not exactly jati, though varna is related to jati. Okay. Now jati itself are not just four. There are so many types of intermixing happening and jatis happening. For example, Karna, they call him Suta, right? Typically the image of a Suta is, because of the TV series in our head, is that he's a Shudra, lower caste. Now, you know, Suta is a mix of Brahmin and Kshatriya. Brahmin and Kshatriya. Think of it. Can it be a lower caste even from the current standards, right?
Actually, you should stop calling it upper and lower anymore.
True, exactly. Exactly. Very, very good point, right? Yeah. It's not lower. It's not horizontal.
Yeah. This is horizontal. Yeah. This is the quality you have. Do this profession.
Absolutely. Right?
And if you can multitask, do multi-professions. No problem.
So that's how the jati thing came about, and it became a monopoly. And going forward, within jatis, whoever had the power, whoever had the money, started, probably there was a lot more discrimination and stuff. And there are traditions because of which people want to stay within the jati. So varna are the qualities you're born with, which all of us are. Now, does that determine your future? I don't think so. Let's take examples from today. What is the jati, so to say, of Narendra Modi? He's a Shudra. Yeah. What is the jati of a president? COVID. He's a Dalit. Like a Varna, if you have to say that, given in the year. Yeah. Not even a Shudra. What was the jati of Sardar Patel? Vallabhbhai Patel, the Iron Man of India. We are talking about pre-independence. he's a Shudra, he's a Patel doing, so Shudras, then they, some of them started taking up Vaishya businesses, but he's a Shudra, right? Let's go back in history. Chandragupta Maurya, this comes from a family of people who took care of peacocks. So again, Shudra. Nandas, they were not Kshatriyas either, right? So many kingdoms in the south were it. So this thing where we are made to believe that Varna, no mobility, is absolutely bullocks. Was there an issue with discrimination? Yes, it happened later on. And is it that only Brahmins oppress Dalits? No. It's not that also. Within that also there are, because inherently human beings are tribal in nature. Should we do something about it? Yes, we are as a country as well. And there has been that awakening as well. Because as I said, we don't say that book mein likha hai, if it's written in the book, that is true, right? We question, we improvise, we move on. So does Varna is like doomed you, does the Varna doom you for life? Not at all. We have thousands of examples also.
In fact, in Bhagavad Puran, there was a common minimum program, you know, common minimum program of the duties that each Varna had to do. Ahimsa, Satyam, Asteya, Akama, Krodha, Lobata. So you need to practice non-violence, truth, non-stealing, freedom from
right.
love, desire. So, I mean, this is this Varna or this Jati is also very recent. Earlier, it was all on the qualities or the inclinations. Krishna says, Shreyan Swadharma Viguna. Follow your Swadharma. Follow what naturally comes to you. Follow your passion. That's what everywhere we see, you know, in the ancient narratives.
And so because you were a Shudra, it was not as if you couldn't achieve moksha or you couldn't achieve liberation.
Correct.
That's also
correct.
Not true. It was available to everybody. And yes. then I want to also talk about this incident from Mahabharata, because people need to know about it. There is an incident called Nahush Prashna. Yeah, they are all in the forest. Bhim, they are staying in Banvas in the forest, and Bhim gets caught by a snake. The snake is named Nahush. And Nahush then calls, so Yudhishthir comes looking. So the snake says, only if you answer my questions will I let Bhima go. One of the questions he asked is that, what if a Shudra has Brahmin-like qualities and a Brahmin has Shudra-like qualities? Then what happens, right? Yudhishthir very, very categorically states that it is only the actions that a person does determines whether he's a Brahmin or a Shudra or a Kshatriya or a whatever, yeah? And again, it's not good or bad. It's what you are.
Right.
If you do bad things, you're bad. If you do good things, you're good. Even if you're Brahmin, if you do bad things, you're bad. And as a Shudra, you do good things, you have Brahmin-like qualities and you can do what you want, how you want to do it.
So all in all, whatever Varna one is born into, first of all, Varnas are all horizontal. They're not vertical. I think the problem started as soon as they went from horizontal to vertical in the way they were listed. So no matter which Varna one is born into, there's absolute complete free will and freedom to switch out of it and do what your nature asks you to do, your personal nature. Got it.
One thing. So one is Varna and one is Jati. Yeah. So
Jati is different. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. But Varna is your own qualities. So you are born with those qualities. Right. So Varna says Brahmin has XX proportion of Sattva Rajas Tamas.
Mm-hmm.
XX proportion of Sattva Rajas Tamas makes you a Kshatriya. Now, if an XX proportion, which is a Kshatriya like proportion, is born in a Vaishya Jati.
Yeah.
Will do the Kshatriya-like activities, or he can, from a Varna perspective.
Right.
Jati perspective, it becomes a little more limited, a little more constrained, or it started becoming as we moved ahead in the time.
Got it. Okay. Looking at the next question, we're up at a few more minutes. Okay. So what is, given all this topic with free will, destiny, you know, what is your message, each of you? Can you take a couple of minutes to message to graduating students from high school, from college, etc., about how they should be viewing their actions, you know, in terms of free will, destiny, how much emphasis should they place on destiny and how much emphasis should they place on free will? Can you give them some parting advice?
I'll just give a quote, you know, again from Upanishad, very similar to what Amiji said. So you are what your deep driving desire is. As is your desire, so is your will. As is your will, so are your deeds. And as are your deeds, so is your destiny. So you, there's a huge choice of free will available. Only thing I feel is while exercising that, one needs to be conscious of righteousness, conscientiousness, resilience, patience, and try to avoid falling prey to overconfidence or instant gratification. Also, kind of have a self-doubt, you know, kind of contemplate. Think if you're doing the right thing at every stage of what you're doing is what I think. And there is no power than right action in the present. So one must take a recourse to self-effort, grinding one's teeth, you know, and overcoming evil by good and fate by present effort. So ultimately, you know, even the hunter has to go hunting. You know, the deer doesn't come to his mouth. Udyamena hi karyanina manorathe nahi tasya simhasya pravishanti mukhe mruga. So right, there's nothing possible without rigorous effort is what I would like to, you know, conclude.
Awesome. Thank you. Amiji?
I would say, remember that you all have the free will to choose. Yes. The problem is not that. The problem is how you choose, right? You can choose based on your impulses, peer pressure. Just because somebody has something, I want to do something. Just because it looks cool, I want to do something. That's one way of doing things. Or I want it because I like it. Simple example. I know cigarette is not good for me, but it gives me pleasure. I have the free will to smoke, so I will smoke. That is a use of free will too. The other use of free will is to use your buddhi, to use our buddhi and say what is good for us. What is good for us? What is good for our family? What is good for the society? So free will you have. How do you choose? Based on only emotions, pleasures, short-term thinking, or using buddhi, self-control to do what is good for all of us in the long term? Point one. Point two. We have all been talking about this, that eventually Daivam can only help if we work, if we have that effort. In Gita, Krishna says, Yoga karmasu kaushalam. Strive for excellence. Whatever you do, do it well. Because if you do it well, you will, whatever be the result, you will have the satisfaction of one, having given your best and enjoying the journey and learning the most from it. The process that of this life is to enrich ourselves with as many learnings and as many experiences. So strive for excellence in what you do. Excellence can only come if you use your buddhi well and you have a sort of self-discipline. So, you know, it's cool to say my way or highway. But eventually, doesn't work. Because there is still an aspect of Daivam, one. And second, unless you do the effort, you won't get it. So I'm repeating myself, but I want to.
But that's how important that is, yeah.
Exactly.
Joseph Campbell says, you know, Joseph Campbell says that passion will move men beyond themselves and their shortcomings.
Absolutely.
And he says that I have no special talent. I am passionately, only passionately curious.
So in Gita, Krishna says.
That is the driving force, you know.
Absolutely. Gita Krishna says, right? So what is the sattvic quality of action? Dhriti utsaha samavinta. So dhriti utsaha, firmness and excitement, resolve, hope, passion. That is important in whatever you do. Yogaha karmasu kaushalam. Never forget that. Strive for excellence. And my last point, have gratitude. Destiny might, I mean, we say it comes from our past karma, right? But we are not born with the awareness of our past karmas. We are born in a family. We are born to certain parents. Things have happened in our life. Like we say, bad things, you know, happened and we had no control. Even good things have happened for which we have had no control. So accept that, acknowledge that, and have gratitude. Having gratitude is very, very important because then it will tell us what matters to us in life more.
Absolutely.
So three things.
Right. And gratitude for even what we consider.
Archanaji, just one thing, you know, whenever something wrong happens to us, we say, why me? But whenever something good happens to us, we never say, why me?
Yeah.
That is what we need to also say, you know, something good happens. Oh, great. Why me? No. Thank God it happened to me.
Right.
You know, the situation for the youngsters, the situation may not be under in your control. but the reaction to your situation is definitely under your control.
And that's where you exercise your free will, you respond to a situation.
Yes. And I would say that, you know, when I consult people who are going through very bad patches in their life, you know, some bad relationships or career, I often prescribe mantra chanting. And I have seen that helps. Mm. See, the situation may not change, but their ability to address the situation or come out of it definitely improves. So some kind of, you know, just as you go to a gym to strengthen your muscles.
And right.
We should strengthen our adhyatmic, each one of us, you know, the youngsters who've come here should try to strengthen their adhyatmic, their atma also, in the sense that they can handle pressures better than many.
Got it.
I say this in my classes. I tell them, don't be a slave to your amygdala. Now, whatever we've spoken of right now, right? If we go back and analyze our entire brain system, it's not very different. It's actually what it is. The mind or the emotions, the mana, which gives us pleasure and pain. That is our limbic system, the amygdala part of it. Now, amygdala also controls our responses. And the neofrontal cortex, the brain also controls our responses. The cortex takes time. It analyzes. Then it makes us respond. But emotional brain, the limbic brain, is quick. I like it. I don't like it, yeah? Doesn't allow me to think at all. So what Ashwini is talking about, practice, right? We have to practice controlling the reactions of our emotional brain. That comes through mantra chanting. That comes through yoga. That comes through self-discipline. When we say self-discipline, we are actually disciplining our emotional system, which runs a riot otherwise in our lives. And let brain control our decisions. So that is the most important.
Beautiful. Thank you. Oh, we have some questions here. Let's see. We have, can this past knowledge come from past lives?
Ashwini.
Okay. Yeah. Past knowledge, yes. There are examples, you know, where children have, a three-year-old starts saying Sanskrit shlokas suddenly, you know, it does come.
Yes.
And there are five koshas, you know, Anna kosh, Pran kosh, Vijnana kosh, Ananda kosh and Mana kosh. They say the Atma carries impressions of these three koshas, that is the Vijnana kosh, Ananda kosh and Mana kosh with it, you know, the impressions of it is carried forward. Even in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says that the new body will have the memories of the past. So yes, some knowledge can come. So you find people, you know, who are inclined towards certain things right from very young age. That is because of their past births.
Got it. Hey, Amiji, here's a question for you. Why does Krishna in Bhagavad Gita do the karma but give away the fruits due to such karma? Does this not break the very basis of the karma cycle?
Say, do the karma but give away the fruits.
But give away the fruits due to such karma. Does that break the karma cycle?
Nothing can break the karma cycle except complete surrender. Surrender of what? Okay, so there is one shloka where Krishna says, Nishtray Gunya Bhava Arjuna. As long as we have Prakriti, the gunas, and we behave according to our gunas, and there is an expectation of a result, with the awareness that I did something, mm-hmm. there will be the karma cycle going on as it is.
Got it.
Now, how do we break the karma cycle? If I do something and I don't want the result to come to me, it can only happen if I don't do it. Yeah? But not doing is not an option. But doing something with the attitude of egolessness, because it must be done, not because I want to do it.
Got it.
That mm-hmm. attitude can break the karma cycle, because it will mm-hmm. not generate a reaction to the action. But I don't know if that's
an answer. Yes, that makes sense. Ashwini ji, is there a place for atheism in Sanatana Dharma?
Atheism?
I'm assuming the question means, is there a place for atheism in Sanatana Dharma? I think that's what
yes.
it means.
Well, atheism is also faith, right? being atheist is also a faith, in my view. And Sanatan Dharma, I don't know whether I'll be able to answer this, but as I said, it propagates duality, non-duality. It propagates saguna, nirguna. It allows us to worship trees and water and sun. And it doesn't say that you have to worship. Ultimately, it says that all paths will lead to moksha. So yes, atheism, there is a place in Sanatan Dharma, even for atheism, I would say. Definitely.
Okay.
Can I add a little bit here?
Yeah.
On the atheism part, it's not directly related to atheism, but in Rigveda, there is a sukta called Na Sidaya Sukta. Na Asit Sukta. Yes. Yeah? Yeah. So it talks about the origin of the universe. It gives a long theory of the origin of the universe. Yeah. And then at the end, it says, this can only be known by somebody who came before the Devas, because Devas also came after the origin happened, right? So if there is somebody who came before the Devas, maybe he knows it, or maybe he doesn't. You know, in Rigveda, which is a theistic text, so to say, there is space for doubt and questioning. Sanatan Dharma has space for doubt and questioning. What we want is our journey and our inquiry. So atheism, I see it as a path of inquiry. Theism also is a path of inquiry, starting from different points. I would still say, don't stick to one belief system. Question, ask, realize. Shravan Manan Nidhi Dhyasa. Hear, inquire, think over it, then realize it, implement it, and feel it. That is where it will take us, rather than sticking to any one belief system just because of sticking to it.
Very, and Sanatan Dharma talks of Paramatma, the primordial undivided consciousness. And Paramatma also means be our divine self. So that's where we need to reach at the end of it. So isn't that, that's like no theism or atheism there. It's reach your own self, you know, your own divine self.
It's interesting that there are lots of questions here, addressing Varna. So I think we may have to do a different discussion on Varna to get to those questions. So I'm just going to stick to the questions about free will and destiny. So here's one more. The division of free will and destiny appears to be artificial and more driven by Western psychology and Western thinking, which are based on Abrahamic influence. Sanatana Dharma views all life as one continuum. Do you agree? Is that your take on it, each of you?
Absolutely. I fully agree with the statement. Because that's what we see in the Panchayatani Mahabahu, that shloka also, right? That everything, success, failure, anything depends on five factors. One of that is destiny. So we are not separating it out. That is how life is, both together. In a continuum. Okay.
Abrahamic religions do not believe in reincarnation. So they do not believe, they only believe in one life. So it's Sanatan Dharma who believes in many lives, you know, and ultimately you break it only when you receive moksha or liberation. So,
okay. I'm looking through, okay, one last question from Deep. Deep has a lot of questions. Jack Ma and Steve Jobs, was it destiny or free will or both? That is, would they have ended up in the same place anyway?
Amiji,
you gave those examples. So this,
I would say you tell me what it is. Is it free will? Is it destiny? Or is it both together working in some way? Right? Making those choices. I mean, at any point in time, both of them had a choice to carry on or to sulk. And a lot of people make the sulking choice as well, right? Like, for example, in very simple things, we have this story of Devdas, who left everything, became an alcoholic just because he couldn't get the woman he loved. Or right. Romeo Juliet, yeah, something of that sort. These are the people who said, fine, whatever went. I am going to now go and do something else. So they made that choice. Now, because that free will happened, other things came into place and they succeeded in whatever they succeeded. Now, one might say that they failed because the destiny had larger in store for them. So it was all still destiny. The thing is, it might still, destiny or no destiny, till they had done what they had to do, that destiny wouldn't have been unlocked. We talk about unlocking destiny, right? Now, destiny in our shastras, we say it is, as Ashwini ji said, based on past karmas also. Considering destiny as destiny only in this one present lifetime also, till there is Purusha, Purushartha, there is no Daiva. That one has to be very clear of. Even if a person is born in the most rich family, people have come down to rags, right?
See, even in the Devi Puran, you know, so I'm a Durga Bhakta. So she says, Aso Raja Athva Ranka, Pandita Athva Burkha, Sarvansi Kari Karma Pravritta. So what is important is doing the karma. So karma has not even escaped God, you know. Vishnu had to fight for 5,000 years to kill Madhukaitava Asur. So it's a metaphor. Devi kills asurs like Durdhara, Durmukha, Bidala. These are what? These are your desires, actually. These are metaphors. But karma has not escaped even gods. Even Vishnu was touched by Vrinda and had to take birth as Ram and Sita, and they had to separate their ways. So ultimately, I feel it's always destiny because of free will. It is never destiny versus free will.
Absolutely. Oh, fantastically put.
Yes, destiny because of that. That's beautiful. Let me see, are there any other questions? Oh, wow. Let's take this last question and then we will wrap it. It says here, does good karma cancel bad? Or this is from Navya. Does good karma cancel bad, or do you carry both good and bad karma separately?
Okay, my understanding of this, there is no canceling happening. It's like stacking up happening. I'm not saying that the result also flow in that way. But I don't think there is a canceling. You do something, you have to face the consequences in whatever way. It's a different thing. Yeah. So doing one good karma, one bad karma, boom. No, it doesn't work that way. Good karma will give you whatever good result. Bad karma will also give you the bad result. That's how I
So it goes back to Ashwini ji's balance sheet.
Just doesn't have an equity or an asset, right? It has working capital and it has loans. So yes, they do not cancel. I agree with Amiji. And what happens is the good karmas possibly lead to lesser, and the person on the good karma path will tend to do lesser and lesser bad karmas automatically, because automatically he will elevate himself in the journey.
Got it. We have requests here to do more such sessions, which is very encouraging. I think it's time to wrap up here. We're past a few minutes. Thank you, Amiji. Thank you, Ashwini ji, on behalf of Indic Academy, for taking time to talk to us. I want to tell you guys briefly what Indic Academy is. We are a non-traditional university for traditional knowledge. We seek to build a global renaissance based on Indic civilizational thought. We are pursuing a multi-dimensional strategy across time, space, and cause by establishing centers of excellence, transforming intellectuals, and building an ecosystem. We are a 501c3 not-for-profit organization here in the US, and all contributions made to it are tax exempt. Please visit our website, www.indicacademy.org. Explore, navigate all our activities, platforms, and initiatives. And do follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at Indic Academy. Wish you all well. Be in touch and go exercise your free will. Namaste.
Namaste. Shubham Bhavati.
Shubham Bhavati.